I will do my presentation in English because I have prepared my slides in English. And I always do it in English, so much more easier. You have correctly pointed out standardization has never been really on the radar screen of the trade unions. This has changed a lot. This has changed over the last couple of years. So I will shortly go into three parts of my presentation, pointing out where there are the standards, why it is important for the trade unions, and then to the real issue, a policy instrument. Do we want it as an upward convergence or not? So let's start with the beginning. Standards are everywhere. Who's moving the slides? Yes. Okay, so let's give you quickly some examples. Many of you came by the airport, and there were airport checks, of course, by private security officers. Well, this is a standard. We have a standard on the private security services at airports, and that is very much used in public procurement, because if there is a call for procurement or public procurement, they just refer to the standard, European standard on private security services airports. And then the many companies they can comply for. Ergonomics is also very much an issue. I was last week at a conference of the hairdressers. Ergonomics for the hairdressers is a very important issue. Now, the way you design your products for the hairdressers, the hair blower is important, because if it is an ergonomic product, according to a standard, then he suffers much more, much less of pain. Quality of care of elderly people. Also, this we are working on a standard at European level. It originates from Sweden, but it goes on all over Europe now. Very few people are working on it, but again, the human factor is very much important there, the worker factor. So this is the reason why we are following it. And then the last one, sustainable and tradable cocoa. It's a very nice one, it's a very hidden one, but it is about the supply chain of cacao. And in it, they are dealing with the farmers in the sourcing countries like Cote d'Ivoire or Ecuador or other countries. Now, you see here a lot of labels, and whenever you go to the product, to buy a product in the supermarket, you say, oh, that's nice, but you don't think about it. Now, behind all these labels are standards. And I loosely group them a little bit, all these labels. On the top corner, on the left-hand side, these are things which you see on food, fair trade. Oats, Bioland, Halal, very famous, well, it's not for the Islamic people, but it is, there is not clear indication what all is behind. On the right-hand side, you see labels which you see on e-commerce sites. TÜV, BE e-commerce. At the bottom, and that is maybe also going on in Italy, in the middle, you see a lot of labels for hospitals and healthcare services. Behind these labels are standards, and they all come from the USA and Canada. And because setting criteria for healthcare in Europe is very problematic, a lot of national member states cannot do it. They are calling upon American and USA standards. For example, in Belgium, a small country, the public authorities don't have capacity to develop standards on healthcare. And what has the minister said? Well, we're going to ask conformity with all the healthcare hospitals according to these labels. But he didn't realize he was asking American standards or Canadian standards. So what is going on? Our healthcare system is very suddenly transformed into an American system. They don't know how much it is going to cost it. It's the first experience they're having. I know it's going on also in Italy and other small countries like Slovenia, In Denmark, they had to stop it because it was too expensive. So the public authorities said, we're on the wrong track. Better track. And wait, just before you go, and on the bottom, can you go back to the labels? The previous one. At the bottom, right-hand side, this is labels which are a bit, which are official, which are calling at ILO standards, and I'm going to deal with the labels which are the CE mark. These are all, what I say now is practical language. It's not formally correct, but in practice, these are the standards which are used by the public authorities, public standard setting bodies, and these are the standards where we, as ETUC, have a say, because in all the other labels, we don't. So I'm focusing on the official standardization, which you see very often with the CE mark. Let's go to the next one. So where is this all coming from? The next slide, please. Yes. So I deal with the formal official standardization. That comes from a regulation. It is a regulation 1025/2012, and it calls up three official standardization bodies in Europe, at the European level. CEN, CENELEC, and ETSI. ETSI, you also know it, but you don't realize it. Your mobile phone, your smartphone, all according to standards of ETSI. If there were not ETSI standards, your smartphone would not work. Maybe you have heard about the 5G already, which is in the pipeline. Actually, the 5G standards, they agreed upon it in December inside ETSI and some other consortia, and they are going to be rolled out now in the coming year. So these are the European ones, and if you go to the next slide, then you have the equivalent national standardization body. So every country has a standardization body. They are all recognized by the national legislators. So it is an official thing. One of the problems which we have at national level is that the national trade unions, they have never paid attention to it. And so we are missing links at national level. There are some good examples in Italy, where we had last November a seminar in Sweden and in several other countries, in Germany. But most European countries, national trade unions link they miss the link with their equivalent national standardization body. And that is important to be able to influence the content of standards. I come back to that later on. So let's go and have a look why it is important for trade unions. Next slide, please. So why must trade unions now take a closer look to it? First of all, in the past, standardization is an old business, an old industry. It exists 100 years. It has changed. It was for and by industry, but with the publication of this new regulation, of which I told you before, it has become a soft regulation tool. And because it is a soft regulation tool, the European Commission is using it a lot, and your national authorities are using it also a lot. And then there is at the European level this policy of outsourcing legislation. It's not an official word, of course, but I call it like that. There's a better regulation policy, a recent discussion. These are all jargons to make legislation simpler and putting the fine details of the legislation in these standards. And that is why trade unions must be there today. It did not exist 15, 20 years ago. It is intensified since the last 5 years. Next slide. Now, a lot of people say standards are voluntary, and they are from a legal point of view. But because they have such a high stakes, because they're used in legislation, they're unavoidable, they're soft regulation. And that is why the regulator uses them to underpin the fine details of their legislation, or very often an alternative. The public authorities, they don't make legislation, and they use the standards as an alternative to legislation. And I can partially understand it, because you cannot put everything in legislation. Sometimes the public authorities need other instruments, policy instruments, than legislation, and so they call up these standards. And then lastly, services. We have a services economy today, and standardization is also moving into that direction. I gave you the examples before, the private security services in the airport, healthcare services, and cleaning services we are discussing. So there is a move to standard services, and then the workers' component becomes very much important. So, next slide, please. So, what is the EDU position on it? Well, first of all, we are, as EDU, in favor for upward convergence, very much a basic issue, and at the same time, we want a more united union, a more united European Union. So, specifically on the standards, we therefore support standardization at the conditions that it provides us a high quality of working conditions. So nothing strange, but it shall not encroach upon existing national labor laws, bargaining, and collective agreements. So that is the basic position of EDU towards standardization. Next one, on the upwards convergence, can we use it then as a policy instrument, which is this session all about? So, yes, we can, but we must be very careful. Standards, because I told you, they can contain labor issues. So, we have positive and negative effects. The positive effect is that a country where there is no social or labor regulation at all, you can use these standards as an alternative policy instrument. And then also it has indirect effects on their social dialogue. But on the other hand, it can have negative effects on those countries which already have high levels of social and labor protection. So, you have to be careful with it. It has positive and negative sides. And the only way to deal with it is by being at the table, to participate, to actively influence the content of the standards. Sometimes trade unions say we should not participate in the standardization, which is a fair point, but then the standards are set without our influence. They come, and we are not at the table. So, therefore, some reflections. Practical reflections. Standard setting is very detailed precision work. Some trade unions, they go to a meeting and they come with policy arguments. Well, it does not work. They speak about details. So it's work for people who have detailed knowledge about clauses and who pay attention to the bottom lines. No big policy setting, working on details. The second thing is global retailers set their own private standards. For example, the big retailers like Metro, Walmart, Asda, Carrefour, they are all in one consortia, and they are setting their own standards on international trade on products outside of the official standardization. We are not there. But these standards, they have big consequences, because if they set their standards and they're going to source their products in Africa, then you can have as much official standards. It is, in the end, the big private global retailers which are setting, which are calling the shots. And then lastly, are we prepared to use these standards as a policy instrument? Also for the lesser advanced member states, the topic which I referred to before, which it can have positive effects upon. So that's a rhetoric question. Before I close down, because we're speaking about the global supply chain, international trade and standards, World Trade Organization, it's not only about customs, it's also about removing technical barriers to trade, products and services. There is a specific chapter on this in the WTO agreement. And if we have, over the last 2 years, discussed so much about our TTIP discussions, about CETA, it's actually not so much about customs. It's not about financial barriers. It's all about recognition of each other's standards, certification systems, quality infrastructure with the big world. So that I just want to highlight, because a lot it is It is not so much put in the light, many people don't realize it. So what can we do here inside the EFIC? We have here now, since the publication of this regulation from the European Commission, with the support, financial support of the European Commission, a small team of people to coordinate the standardization activities. We can provide the support and advice. We know how it works. We can train people who say we want to participate, and we can influence the standard testing activities, not only at the European level, but also at international level. For example, in the coming 3 weeks, there is a meeting going to take place of ISO, the International Standardization Organization, on human resource management in Paris. And we are going to participate because we really believe that it's very important to be there, because if we are not there, the standard comes out without our participation and without our influence. So, with this I want to conclude, but I remain here at your disposal for further questions. Thank you.